where's God given you? Immediately again, come back and refocus. You pray for those who God has given me. Everybody on earth will be covered in prayer. But who has God given you?
That's right.
And if you're called to intercede and pray for the nation, which nation? So start focusing so that you intercede and you pray and power into those people's lives. And you redirect your arrows and everything. That will stop us from these general prayers, religious prayers, trying to impress people in the prayer groups. All the beautiful words. But if you look at the spirits, it's this big. Yeah? It's to refocus. God, you go back to Muslim. Who have you put across my way? Who do I need to intercede for, pray for? I know a lot of churches, and it's all over the world. You've got all these intercession groups. 99% of them are just plain prayer groups. Because intercession is out of third heaven.
Yeah, come on.
Most prayer groups, second heaven prayers.
Yeah.
Intercession is out of a place of rulership.
Out
of one's eye,
yeah.
In heaven, down. That's why intercessors need to be taught. They need to be shown how to enter into heaven, how to start interceding, how to rule with the Father.
Yes, come on.
Out of third heaven.
That's good. That's good.
All and all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I'm glorified in them. When Jesus died, what happened? Your inheritance was activated.
Amen.
All he is yours, your son. All these is yours. What do you need to do? You need to take possession of what's yours. How do you steward it? How do you rule it? Does God get glorified through it? And again, we live to one day go to heaven to have a good life. You're supposed to step in that inheritance now. You need to manifest it now. Show the people so that your Father can be glorified. Why is there so much poverty in the world? Because we have not taught the people. We have not set the example how to step up in intimacy and step in the provision of heaven. Now I'm not more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. I'm not in the world. Don't see yourself in the world.
Come on.
Those that you have given me, Father, I give them back to you. You keep them. Why? You've got another assignment. You are built for eternity. You have been created for eternity. Trust God. Same with your children. Do you trust God in them?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No, people don't. Short something to think about. So, for example, we have this meeting tonight. Suddenly you phone, I can't come, my boy has got flu. What have you done? You've just given the devil the key to keep you at home in the future from all your blessings and things that you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
Trust God with your boy with flu.
Yeah.
I even excused this and stuff. At this party, I said, my dog's nose was running yesterday. It's much better today, but I just want to make sure tonight it's not running. Yeah, believe me. You get crazy excuses. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. How do you keep them in the way? By you walking inside of God. What do you keep them in the name? When you manifest the names of God that are set apart and you walk in that provision and they see it and they encounter it. God's names are set apart, above, elevated, and those names are being imparted in you. You've been ordained with them. You've been put in your DNA. Everything is in there. None of them is lost. A godly lifestyle must be that you've got a desire that none that has been put across your way will ever get lost. And you're going to walk with some people and they're going to go astray. But don't just reject them and throw them away. You keep on praying they've been put across your way. There's one thing in heaven that Jesus always cries about when you talk to him. If you talk to him about the loss. Always. I can't think of one time that he did not cry. That should be our desire, that we get in such a place of intimacy and unity that we make sure none get lost. That you do everything in your ability. It means everything through Him. Him through you. To get that person saved. That we don't look in the natural of what that person has done. That we acknowledge that there are demonic spirits and darkness, that we need to get rid of them and those darkness around them and get the good out of the person, because everyone was created good. Amen. Stop looking in the natural, start looking in the spirit, start going to Ephesians 6 about your wars in the spirit. But the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And now I come to you. And these things I speak in the world that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. If they see the manifestation of Jesus, they'll be filled with joy. Joy of your Lord, your strength. What is it about? It's not about walking around and telling jokes and just laughing all day. It's got nothing to do with the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is alignment of the heart. It's a place where your hearts align to peace. You can't separate joy and peace. Peace, joy, excitement. Amen. That you are bubbling. You can't stop yourself. You're like a fountain. You're like a volcanic outburst because of the presence of your Father. What is the joy of the Lord all about? It's about sound and fragrance. Those of you who've been involved with deliverance sessions, when sometimes when you deliver some demonic powers, they really stench. Yeah. Yes. Oh, it's disgusting. Exactly the same with you and me. When we walk out of the chamber of the heart of God, we'll talk about chambers of the heart tomorrow maybe, the four chambers. You walk out of that place of peace, of excitement, of joy, of love. You release a sound of heaven, a fragrance of heaven, which is a bad sound to darkness. It reminds Satan of what he would have had if he did not have pride. It's a stench to them. What happens? A joy of your Lord's strength. If you've got that place in your heart, you release heaven and the devil can't come close to you. They hate given the presence of the Father. Why? Because you are getting what you were supposed to have. You and I need to do, we need to release it, they need to see it, that peace. Doesn't matter of your circumstance, it doesn't matter and what frustration you are, it doesn't matter. Exodus 33:14, one of my first verses that God gave me when I got saved. My presence and my peace will always be with you. So once you haven't got peace in you, no matter what your circumstances are, you've moved out of the presence of God. Mm. Wow. I've given them thy word, and you have hated them. And the world has hated them. Oh, not you. Because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Again, I said it how many times tonight. You are not of this world. And once you're going to step into the supernatural, the spiritual realm, people are going to hate you.
Amen.
They're going to reject you. You're even going to be thrown out some churches. Yeah? Fact. Instead of us being excited for the kingdom, for God, if people move in the spirit, we try to stomp them down and to control and manipulate them. I always tell them they're not ready, they're not married, or they're in some other spirit. When we do that, it just exposes our own identities and our own relationship. When you feel threatened by other people moving in the spirit, there's something wrong if you get rid of your pride. Get rid of yourself. Kingdom is, you get excited if you see somebody standing up in the power.
Yeah.
It's good for my Father. He loves it. Everything that He loves, you should love as well. I pray not that you should take them out of the world, but you should keep them from the evil. Who should keep them from the evil? Once you have manifested and shown them God, Holy Spirit. You have shown them God, you've manifested it. What happens? They receive the Holy Spirit, you've taught them, you've shown them how to hear the voice of God. So Father, I ask that you never stop speaking. Can I tell you something? There's not one second that God does not talk. The times that we don't hear Him, the times that we are not in unity with Him. He warns you about everything in life. Even if there's a stone in the road, you're going to bump your toe, and He shows you the stone, He warns you. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Saint, listen to this, great key. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. I'm just going to carry on quickly reading and I'm coming back there. As you have sent me into the world, even so I also send them into the world. What is part of your duty? To equip, to train, to show, and to release. Not manipulate and control and form your own gang and you're just a man.
Amen.
Equip and release. Equip and release. Send them into the world. Duplicate. Duplicate Jesus. And for their sakes I sanctify myself. This is Jesus speaking. That they also might be sanctified through what? The truth. Sanctification, how does it work? And if we go to verse 17, verse 19. I sanctify myself with the Spirit of truth. Why? So that I can sanctify others. What happens when I lay hands, whatever, when I impart them, I impart them with truth. They get cleansed because Jesus comes into them. That is what's going to happen in the season. Well beyond that. Lord's releasing a spirit of truth upon this earth. And you're going to see people being exposed. People being embarrassed. Leaders, everything, all dimensions. And that's why, people, get the truth in your heart. The truth about God. The truth of who He is. Truth about yourself. That's your key. Sanctify yourself with truth. And that's why it's so important, again I say, when you've got intimacy, you've got a relationship, when you go to Him, that He tells you, there's no doctrine, there's no religion, philosophy, tradition involved. He said it. That is your best source, directly from the fire, Father, not via somebody else and other things. It's a time of sanctification. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which you shall believe on me through their word. That they all may be one as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. That they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. There comes back to unity, walking inside of them, that they walk with you inside of them. What is he talking about? All of us becoming back and stepping to out to becoming brides. One, unity. That is how we need to teach them. That's how we need to show them how to become brides again. How to submit under the authority of the bridegroom. Your marriage agreement. You're baptized in the cloud of Moses. Your marriage agreement. We'll talk, maybe talk about that tomorrow. Not like in the natural, we as men. Hey, you better listen to me. You're my wife. You better submit. My question is, we as men, what are you giving them to submit to? Come on. Do you want your wife to submit to you? And you're not giving them Jesus to submit to you. You're busy with witchcraft, manipulation. That should be a desire in you. Give them Jesus, then that for the natural move that they will submit. Die for her. You prepare to die for her. The glory which you gave me, I've given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Here's another thing. Whatever you receive from God, are you keeping it for yourself or are you giving it out?
Amen.
What do people do? They keep it for themselves. They're so afraid the person next door is going to be greater than them. Give it out. Why? Because you need the new wine. You need the new revelation. You need the greater thing. You need, we'll talk about it tomorrow, set a new crown. New mandates, new authorities, new provision. Give it. Let me give you another key while we talk about it. You only give what your Father tells you to give. Mm-hmm. True in I believe, this personally, Etienne. I believe that 90% of what I see and hear, I never release. You people, because it's a trust relationship. You only release when God tells you to release. That's where so many people in the prophetic get hurt. The right word at the wrong time is wrong. That's got a backlash. And bite you in the back. It's a fact. Everything about God's about trust this one. Can He trust you with His word? With His secrets, His mysteries, His treasures. With His revelation. Talking about revelation. It's a season of revelation of the greater things. How do I get the keys and the mysteries and the secrets of heaven? John says, and Paul says in Ephesians 3, the mysteries of heaven I received through revelation. This is one of the translations says, which is beautiful, says, the mysteries of heaven are seated in revelation.
Wow. Good.
So your life must be filled with revelation. If you read your word every day, you must have so many new revelations. I think it's a Hebrew that thing in the scriptures, each and every passage has got at least 40 layers. That's what a rabbi told us in Jerusalem. Revelation is a secret. That's part of how your spirit man feeds. You get the word of God, you get encounters that feeds them, the presence of God, it grows them in the word. But I tell the people, revelation is like you're giving it a steroid. It just bolts up. It's there. Mysteries and secrets. That's why you need to desire it. You need to desire that intimacy to bulk up.
Good word.
That the devil start fearing you. I and them and you and me, and they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and has loved them as you have loved me.
Amen.
I and you, you and me, and they in you. Where do you see yourself? Do you visualize yourself inside of Him? God says, I've got feet of brass. What does it mean? You've got feet of brass because you're inside of Him. Depends how big you look at your spirit. Revelation 1, where He descends from heaven. Are you in that vision when you look at it? Colossians 3 verse 4 said, when I descend, you will descend with me. She says all the things about shifting our mind, shifting our vision, and start beginning and thinking like God. Start and take up our positions. That's actually what we need to do. Start believing and trusting Him. What He says in His word is the truth. I think it's in Numbers 23:19. It says that God can't lie. But do you believe Him? Or should I ask? If you believe Him, do you live Him? All of us. Father, I will that they also may know that you have given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which you have given me, for you love me before the foundation of the world. Verse 23, we go back to 23, says that they may make perfect in one. What does the churches say up there, the traditional churches? You cannot move into perfection. If you were created to the image of God, there's a possibility of you stepping back into that perfection.
Yes.
It's different realms, and you get to, I'm just going to say something quickly, don't, I'm going to go into there now. You get realms like you get to meet Jesus as the Lord. It's a realm that you get to encounter, and you get his characteristics, everything, mandates, everything. Then you meet him as Lord of Lords. Then you meet him as King, King of Kings. Then you meet him in the realm of eternity. Then you meet him in the realm of perfection. Many things we can carry on for days and nights on those things. Don't go there now. For you love me before the foundations of the world. God already showed his love, his perfection to you before you were in the mother's womb, before the foundation of the world. And he just sent his son Jesus back to really try to wake us up, to come and confirm his love, to come and tell us, listen, I have given you everything. I've given you everything. Please come to me. That you start realizing that he loved you first. It's not that you need to go and seek his love. You've got it. It's been given to you. He's shown it. He's proved it. But we need to learn how to receive it, how to live it, how to acknowledge it, how to release it. I've just written a foreword now for the book that was released last week, 2 weeks ago, of Bob Jones, who was my spiritual dad, who passed away last year in February. The book's called Did You Learn to Love? And there's a testimony when Bob died and went to heaven, that there were two lines in heaven. 98% of people in a line and 2% in another line. And your spirit, listen to what I'm saying, your spirit can never lie. Who lies? Your soul. So Jesus went to each and every person in the line and said, did you learn to love? And in the long line, the answer was, no, Lord, we did not. Gone to hell. In the short line, yes, Lord, we learned to love. They went to heaven. But in front of Bob was a lady. He said he thinks she's in the 90s. She was filled with a body of pain and arthritis and everything. And the Lord asked her, did you learn to love? And her answer was, Lord, you know, I loved you with my whole being. And then he said, yes, I know that I'm your first love, but you did not love your neighbors. But you went to heaven because he was first love. This is the season that we are now, as we get back into that love. First love. We need to know that he loved us first. He has provided, he's given everything. But he needs to see whatever he's going to release in your life is not going to form a wedge between you and him. That it's going to bring him closer. It's not going to separate you. He will not give you anything that will separate you from him. He's a God of unity, he's a God of love, he's a God of oneness, God of intimacy. That's what we need to start with. We need to get back into a lifestyle of worship, thanksgiving, praise, a lifestyle. Not sessions of worship and praise that is amazing and we must always have it. Never stop it. But your worship, your praise, your thanksgiving must never stop. Every moment, a moment of glorification. Every night when you go to bed, even when you are sleeping. Your body must worship. Your cells must worship God. Release the sound. Lord, let my body rest. And keep my spirit awake and pardon and let my spirit worship you. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for reminding us who you are. Also thank you for reminding us how much you love and what you've given us. Also thank you for reminding us who we are in you and you in us. And we declare that tonight we're going to stand up in this place with a new authority, a new passion, a new fire. To step into that fullness, that perfection that you have given us. Ask that you give us discernment. Give us wisdom. Revelation, knowledge, understanding. How to steward your blessings, your gifting from heaven. How to steward the kingdom of heaven here on earth. How to glorify you. Ask you to come and occupy our gates of first love. The Spirit received you on our throne of first love. Our desire is to not one moment be separated from you, but that we are knitted and woven into you each and every second, and that your DNA gets activated in us, that we take on your genealogy, your heart, everything, become that reflection that you desire us to be. And we thank you, Father. Lord, I ask that you will bless each and every person here, each and every family represented here, each and every church that's represented here, with the fullness of your love. Thank you for that, Father, in the name above all names, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Tomorrow what we'll do is we'll activate everything. We will do in one session, we'll do a bit of activation. In the next session, we'll lay a hand for impartation as well. Get your eyes and ears open, to get your senses activated, and to get your revelation, everything activated inside of you. So go and step into that unity. Get everything between you, God, out of the way. So when you receive tomorrow, you receive the fullness. Not just a portion, everything. I bless you all. Love you all. Enjoy.
If you want to hang out, have fellowship, just hang out. We've got food in there. We just have some good, awesome people to hang out with. And in this room here, there's some really awesome people. So I love you guys. And tomorrow, what is it, honey?
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock tomorrow. And then we have a tomorrow night, too, at 7. So... God is good. Amen.